Good evening, everyone. My name is Christine, and I'm assistant curator for the Niagara Falls History Museum. And welcome to Not at the Museum Thursday Nights. And as usual, I would like to begin our program with a land acknowledgement. So the Niagara Region of Ontario is located on the traditional shared territory of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and Chinatown peoples. The Chinatown people have called these lands home for thousands of years, and more recently, the Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee have been sharing the land as one dish, one spoon treaty territory. So over the last several years, we've been bringing you the Coming Out Story series, which have now evolved into the Living Out Stories. As always, these evenings are designed for LGBTQ+ and straight communities alike. Each night, we welcome a different special guest to share their personal experiences of living out in their lives and communities. I am thrilled that the museum has been seen as an ally and a safe space to help facilitate these much needed conversations in the Niagara region. So thank you so much for joining us tonight. This program offers an open dialogue about gender and sexuality. So please note there are references of a sexual nature during the conversation. And without further ado, I would like to introduce the person who is responsible for this series, whose tireless efforts have brought some of the most beautiful and thought-provoking programs into the museum, tonight's host, Falynn Shaw.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Christine.
You're welcome. I'll go away now.
Okay, we'll see you soon. Good evening, everyone. Falynn Shaw here, and I'm going to be welcoming B. Bertrand. Just get them on the screen.
Hi, friends. Hey, buddy.
Hi there. Thank you so much for coming on my show.
Thank you so much. I'm thrilled. I feel like we're old pals.
It does seem like we've been friends for a while.
I know. I really am thrilled to be hanging out with you and doing your show.
Yeah, I'm so happy that you said yes. Over the years that I've been following you on social media, I feel like I've gotten to know you. You're pretty, like, you share things pretty candidly. You're pretty honest about the things that you talk about, which is part of the, you know, what intrigued me and kept me watching. So I want to let everybody know you are a comedian, an amazing comedian. In case anyone didn't know, B. Bertrand is a Toronto comedian. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. This all feels so surreal. I feel like before the pandemic, I've been doing comedy for about 2 years. And I felt like I was just trying to say yes to everything, which is great. But I also got such anxiety when I was doing comedy. And I was trying to like figure out how to like crack the code kind of what I needed to feel more comfortable. But then the pandemic happened and like, I feel like a lot of people, I just kind of spiraled into being an anxious nightmare and I didn't do anything for like 3 years. And then I just, a lot of stuff like everyone happened over the pandemic and I was really sad. And then so, like with you saying that I've been really honest on social media, somebody that I really love and respect was doing a show and messaged me. And I don't think they were trying to be funny, but it made me laugh. And they were like, I follow you on social media and I'm doing a show about being sad. And I think it'd be perfect for you, which is really funny because I think I was a Debbie Downer for a while on social media.
That's interesting.
I know. And I had no intention of doing comedy for a while because I felt like I'd kind of lost my funny. But then this year, I feel like I'm being given opportunities to make up for the time that I feel like I was trying to do my best, but I wasn't quite nailing it. So
You're finding that funny again. And honestly, yeah. I think it's great you mentioned the anxiety. So many of us struggle with anxiety. Not enough people, I think, talk about it, because if they did, there wouldn't be such huge stigmas attached to it. But that's something that I deal with too. You know, it really is. And then the pandemic kind of made things, it was a whole different bag of nuts. And the anxiety was different too. So I love that you mentioned that. And I love that you were able to like, you know, find your funny again.
I'm trying. I think that I just have a whole new mindset and I'm feeling really good and excited. And I think there would be a time where I would never do a show like this because I would be so in my head and so worried about, you know, messing up whatever that looks like. But that's, you know, selfishly, I am really thrilled for this opportunity because I love you. And this is like, this feels really nice. It feels really nice.
Good. I always hope when I have guests on the show that it's a good experience for them. And it's not, I mean, it can be a little nerve wracking because we're going to talk about your life, right? And all the different things that that looks like. So it's not easy. But I mean, if I would have asked you a couple of years ago, you wouldn't have been maybe in the place you needed to. So it worked out the way it was supposed to.
Yeah, totally.
I have a few questions about your humble beginnings. Let's talk about family. Let's talk about a little bit about when you first came out, because I know in your case, there's a couple coming out stories. You know, one, I'll let you, you're the one that knows. I'll let you explain.
I came out, my mom, I always tell this story the same because I think it is such a funny visual that my mom asked me in a moving vehicle when I was 15 if I was gay. So I had nowhere to go. I definitely wasn't ready to tell her, but I did. And it was fine. And everything was fine. I mean, she always knew, but it's really funny. Her tell wasn't anything that I was expecting. I wore a hat all the time. I normally wear a hat all the time, but she took that as this like gay cover up, like this, I don't know, this hat was like a symbol for covering up and not, I don't know, being confident or something. So she called P-flag, which I think the conversation must have been so funny because she, I feel like she was probably like, my kid is wearing a hat all the time, are they gay? Which is really silly and funny. And so I always looked queer. So I wasn't fooling anyone. I knew I was gay really young, and yeah, it was cool. Everybody kind of knew, and I'm 40 now, so like 25 years ago.
Oh, nice.
You're 40?
I just turned 40 on March 1st.
Oh my God, happy birthday. I always assume I'm older than everyone, but like 25 years ago, I don't know how it was for you, but I feel like they're, with no disrespect to how people, you know, kind of functioned, I feel like there was a lot of family members that were like, none of anyone's business. So they didn't ask me, but everybody kind of knew and everybody was fine.
It's like an unspoken truth that a lot of people just assumed. I also wore a hat all the time. I was incognito.
Oh my God.
That's so what I was thought amazing. I was being, was just incognito, but apparently I was being a heavy homosexual. my mom never asked me. Right. My mom never asked. I did eventually come out to my dad, but yeah, people knew. And it was we were the latchkey kids, you know, we were like cooking dinner and watching the kids and stuff. So we were already little adults. So you didn't really come out to your mom then. She kind of like got that out of you, which is cool because I think it's interesting that your mom called P-flag. I think that's kind of a beautiful thing. That's what they're there for, right? So I think that's, you know, shout out to P-Flag for all the hard work and all the volunteers and everything there. I was just going to say, like, it was pretty much good with everybody else too. Like, you didn't have any pushback.
No, everybody was so sweet. It is a funny thing looking back. And I feel like as queers, we can say things that sound stereotypical, but we get it. When I say things like, I mean, nobody was picturing me with a boyfriend. And so it is funny looking back, you know, I first said when I was young, I thought I was a tomboy and then everybody knew I was gay. My grandma, who we have always been so close. I remember.
Is that the one? Is it the one that you show all the time? Okay, go on.
Yeah, it's, you're so sweet about my grandma and.
I love old people so much.
I know. And she's such a sweetheart.
Like elderly, I should say. I love the others.
Yeah, I know. And it is really lovely because, you know, my grandma's 88 and the elderly, they really, you know, we give them a lot of leeway because they're from a different time. So when somebody is like just on board for whatever and lovely and accepting no matter what, it is just like so heartwarming. And I remember when I told my grandma I was gay, I was also, I didn't realize I was trans until quite later, but I was wrestling with some things. But when I told her, she said, because at the time I was her only granddaughter and that was a very important thing. And so I remember she said, I don't care who you are and who you love, as long as I get to see you in a beautiful white wedding dress on your wedding day. And, you know, and I didn't say it at the time, but I remember thinking, what is your second choice? But she's fine.
What's your second choice? That's nice, though. I love the sentiment, though, that like doesn't matter who you are. And who's to say you don't wear a beautiful white suit, you know?
That's true, Falynn.
You do share a lot about your grandma, and I think it's beautiful. You're very, like, real with her, too, and I think that that's great. I think a lot of us tiptoe around the older generations and think we can't be who we are because we have to fit in a box. I'm definitely like you in that way, very open, and I think that we don't give some people enough credit.
Yeah, totally. I feel like also, I mean, I guess it depends on your personality, but the people that I've met through my grandma that are her age, like her little pals and stuff, I feel like they get a real kick out of having the younger generation treat them like a pal and say silly, wild things. And, you know, I feel they value 100%. Them. Yeah.
I love that. Okay. So I want to kind of like tell people a little bit more about like what you do, because you do comedy, but you also are a bit of an activist. I mean, I don't know if you would call yourself that, but you definitely stand tall for some really important issues. So I don't know if you want to talk on that.
Yeah, I feel like also I just can't stop telling people this because it feels freeing, but also it's a lot. But I feel like I'm trying to acknowledge my feelings and my busy brain because I was just recently diagnosed with ADHD. So I feel like I'm trying to reel myself in and make my stories more compact. But I feel like to explain my social media, it is like a mixture of wholesome and political and silly, and a lot of different things. And I feel like over the pandemic, I have just been trying to figure out ways at first to kind of like, you know, it's that whole projection thing, make other people feel safe and warm and cozy is what I always say. Mm-hmm. But then also secretly, it's to make me feel like everything's going to be okay too. So, I think my comedy is all over the place. I like it to be wholesome and absurd is what I always say. And I first started out doing comedy. I was doing these bits where I don't know if you've ever done this, you probably have better things to do with your time, but I don't.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Every single, like once you accept a friend request from one spammer, you get them all the time, like daily. And I accepted the friend request from this Nigerian barrister, and he wanted to gift me dead secret relative money. And I was so invested. I thought this was so funny, and I was so sad. So I wanted to see how far I could push this. And I told this is not painting me in a good light, but I pushed this daily for 8 months, like just all these interactions. And it was so funny to me because it just had twists and turns, and I was posting it and people were into it. And so then I started responding to more spammers and posting it. And then I started this job being a production assistant for commercials in Toronto. And it was a really grueling job, and I was working like 14 to 20 hour days, and I would work on commercials that would be, they would make me so frustrated that I would start to write sequels to these commercials and make them so absurd. So one of those, I had been going to open mics for so long, and I never thought that I would have, like, I didn't do anything there. I just watched them and I love them, but I didn't think I'd have the guts to do them. So one day I just read this really silly commercial I had written, and people really liked it and it felt nice. And so I just kept writing more. And the comedy that I was doing wasn't really conventional because people weren't really going up to the mic and reading out the silly stuff they had written. But for some reason, it was just working for me and I was getting a little bit more confident. So for like the first couple of years I did comedy, I was just kind of reading out really silly things that I had written.
I actually watched online, I watched you talk about the barrister, and I really thought it was interesting because I too have had fun with some scammers, you know, not 8 months fun, but I, you know, just a quick reply or whatever, but it is fun. And I can see how that would be hilarious to read at comedy.
Yeah, people, I mean, I think 8 months is ridiculous, but
that's the best part though.
I commit, Falynn. I do commit. But I think everybody, I mean, I think being relatable is so funny and I value that. So whenever I did bits like that, people would laugh because they're like, either did it themselves or they'd be like, I always thought about antagonizing a spammer and now I will do that, which is very funny to me.
Let's talk a little bit about Stories with B. Is this something you did over the pandemic or was this something you had started prior to the pandemic? We can tell people a little bit about Stories with B, give them a little background.
I remember when the pandemic first happened, it was 2 days before my brother's birthday and I was going to go see him on his birthday. And this whole thing was so wild. And I remember saying, it's fine. I'll just come and see you next week when it's over, which is so ignorant and not at all, obviously, what had happened. So I think like everybody, I just spiraled and it was like, you know, a day and then a week. And I was so spun and anxious. And so my mom had kept all the I call them bedtime stories, but all the books that we had my brother and I when we were kids. And for some reason, even though I've lived in the tiniest of places, I had kept them all and moved from apartment to apartment. And I had about 200 books. And so I thought one night when I was really sad, I would just read a bedtime story because I felt like I wanted some softness and something kind. And so I read one and I just posted on Instagram and people liked it. And I thought that was a nice thing and that felt nice. And then the next day people were like, well, where's the bedtime story? And I was like, oh, okay. So I posted another one. And then I feel like my sense of time over the pandemic has been really compromised, but there was so much happening in the world that I did a week's worth of bedtime stories and people really were responding and strangers were responding. And it developed this really lovely, wholesome community of people who just wanted something nice. And so I tried to craft them for what I felt was what I needed and what people might need. And I started the, you know, a special beginning and what you have developed. I was going to say, oh, perfect timing, Falynn, the special drink.
That's why I grabbed it.
Cheers, buddy.
I mean, I've always needed a special drink. I just didn't have a name for it. So
yeah.
Thanks to me.
Yeah, you started off with a special drink and a nice telling you something nice and then read a story and then telling everyone they did their best and their best is more than good enough. And then if there's, I think that's when talking about whatever's going on in the world and political issues came in because it was like, we can't not acknowledge these really important things and kindness. And I mean, there was a lot of kids watching. So that was interesting to see how to speak about things like being kind and queerness and racism and things that were going on in the world, how to kind of say it in a way that was digestible and
gentle
for anyone watching, you know, to value these things that are very important.
I think at that time, we all kind of needed a little escape, a little bit of softness, gentle I mean, I know just personally what I went through, like, you know, you never really knew what was going on. So it was a bit of a chaotic time mentally for a lot of people. So I think what you were doing was great. Are you getting back into it now?
Yeah, I did like almost a year's worth. There's about 260, which I guess half a year, maybe.
And they're on YouTube, right? People can still find them.
They're on my Instagram, #BedtimeStoriesWithB. But it is really funny because also at the time I started transitioning and there was a lot of kids watching. And so I was really open about stuff like that because I was like, there were some parents that I was really happy felt comfortable enough to message me and say, my kid is wondering, are you a boy or a girl? And I was like, that's awesome. There is, kids are so honest and I love that so much. And so I was doing them almost every night. And then a lot of stuff happened over the pandemic that just kind of filled my brain too much. But then recently I look very different and I sound very different. And so I started to do them again. And it's really lovely because it's like the same kids that are like, okay, we're doing it again.
Oh, I love this.
I know, it's so cool. And
kind of cathartic for you, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's really nice. I didn't have anyone to look at and be like, you know, like a lot of us, I mean, queer or trans, I didn't know anything. I didn't have anyone to look at and be like, this is a nice normal representation of who I think that, you know, I am.
And this is part of the reason why you're on the show, so that other people, I can show other people someone. The biggest part about doing this show was I wanted everybody to be able to see themselves in some aspect of like one episode or another. So having you on here and being able to have you be visible is just so important. Thank you.
I love you. I love what you're doing. And I feel really honored to be a part of it because there was a very long time in my life that I didn't think I would have the guts to be open with everyone about being trans, because I did realize that quite later on in life. So this feels awesome to be on your show as a trans person and have an honest conversation.
Yes, and I want to talk more about your transition and when you started. So do you think that during the pandemic, you really had that time to like get to know yourself a bit more, a little more time on your hands and start your journey?
But not the trans. It was about after I turned 30. I don't really know when, but I realized that I was not okay being regarded as like a tomboy. And I was not okay with she, her pronouns. And I feel bad saying this. I'm trying not to feel bad because everybody comes out when they are ready. And that is super valid. And I would never put parameters on someone else. But I do wish that I had been able to come out to my family earlier, but I was really scared. And so it was a really weird world I was living in because my friends knew I was trans and my partner at the time knew I was trans when I realized, and now my partner that I have now, we started dating and she knew that I was trans, and it was a really weird world because I had to be like, oh, in comedy too, I had to establish myself as a trans man doing comedy. And everybody was on board and everyone was so great. But then when my family would come to shows, I'd be like, this is really wild, but I need you to misgender me because I haven't told my family. And it was really, it's a really normal thing for trans folks, but I feel like saying that to cis people, I feel like it was kind of funny because they look at me like, is this a trap? Like, no, I'm not allowed to do that. And I'm like, no. You have to, like, this is a very real thing that happens and it sucks. And I'm going to tell them, I don't know when, but it's definitely not tonight before I do 7 minutes on the stage. So, I mean, even my partner too, had got really good at not using any pronouns, which I think would have probably been exhausting for her. So I was just sick of it. And I was like, I got to tell them. I mean, I love them and they deserve to know. And I know they do know, but it is really weird. Like what we've talked about, you think you're going to come out once in life and you're like, I'm queer and that's it. And then like 20 years later, you're like, oh my gosh, that's not it. How do you, you know, it's very black and white when you're like, I love who I love. And everyone's like, oh, I get that. But then you're like, I'm not the gender that everyone thinks I am. And then for some reason, people get really skeptical, like they know you better than you know yourself, you know? It's very strange that that can't also be black and white, but it is harder coming out as trans, in my experience.
Yeah. So you were able to, when, just timeline, when were you able to kind of come out and let them know, like, I'm a trans man?
Carly, my partner, we were dating. We started dating at like the pandemic. So we couldn't have a normal relationship where we would meet each other's parents and each other's mm-hmm. friends, because that just wasn't a possibility. And so it was like 2 years into us dating, I think. And I was like, we can't be in a relationship and avoid meeting each other's families and all these things. If, you know, my mom has to, and my brother and my grandma, I got to tell them that I'm trans. This has been too long. And so we found this falafel place that we loved over the pandemic. And so we got these falafels and we drove to Pickering. And I was so scared. That was 2 years ago in August. And I was so scared. And then I opened my mom's door and then I didn't see my mom or my brother. They always greet me at the door. They were upstairs, but somebody pressed play and they started playing I'm Coming Out. And so I started laughing and crying. And I'm like, oh, they know that this is like the visit where I'm going to talk. Wow. And so it was really sweet. <That's beautiful. laughs> it was easy to tell them. It was hard, but it was one of those
things. You had to be in a place where you were comfortable with them knowing that.
Yeah, it was like one of those things where you're like, I need you to ask me if I'm a man because I physically can't say this to you. And so when they put on that music, it was like silly and sweet. And it was a big day, but it was really cool.
Wow. That's amazing. I'm just going to do a quick time check because I honestly could talk to you forever, but I really want you to bring your girlfriend on. We've talked a bit about Carly, but I mean, if she's willing to come on and have a chat with us, I think it would be beautiful.
Carly. I could hear her being so quiet outside the door. She just did her hair. She was sitting with our cats. Oh, is this that thing where I have to, we're sitting in two chairs that are very different heights. Okay, how do I?
Hi, Carly. Oh. Welcome to the show.
This is Falynn. This is Carly.
Nice to meet you. I feel like I know you a bit through social media. One thing I know is that you two love each other a whole lot and it comes through, like you can feel it. So yeah. I had mentioned to B that it would be nice to have you on. I don't normally get to have a guest and their partner come on and share a little bit about themselves and their relationship. So thank you for coming on.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
No problem. So you got together in the beginning of the pandemic.
It was right before, 3 months.
Oh, so you actually knew the real world before, like you were able to go out and know what not.
We had a few dates, yeah. Not very many. We're both working pretty full time at the time. Yeah.
So then that happened, and like you were saying, we weren't able to kind of do the whole parent thing.
Yeah, it was interesting. We talked about it too. I feel like we really got to know each other. We spent a lot of quality time together, like days on end. We started seeing each other through like our highest stress times, how we deal with, you know, like high levels of pressure and uncertainty and sort of panic and fear, but I still didn't know any of his friends or hadn't met his family. And it was like, you know, so you sort of like tiptoe through meeting people, and then usually you sort of get down to like the hard stuff, but we did a little backwards.
Yeah.
And then they're probably curious, right? Because they know they can't really meet. And I know that that probably was hard for your family to not get to know who you're dating as well. Yes. As they probably want to.
Yeah.
Everything was so weird. I do feel like it is important to acknowledge, even though you roll your eyes, that when we first met, I was having a very anxious night, and it was a series of events that, by all accounts, I was dead set on not going out, and we met, but I thought Carly was a babe alert, and we started talking, and I had no idea if she was queer or not. And
never does.
And that we talked a lot, and I still didn't know, and then we hung out once with people, and then I still didn't know, and then we hung out twice, and then I knew because she smooched me.
Yeah.
Oh, then you found
out. I was
out.
Like, that's far.
Oh, so you had no idea. Like, I would have been like, what, how do I feel? What do I do?
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like I try really hard to be, I mean, not overly queer, but just like, you know, like I'm just myself, and I'm like, I think this is good enough, but
no, for sure.
Things just don't ever work out for me. And so I was thrilled, but also I should have known because she asked me if I wanted to come over and watch the L Word, and I was like,
yes, pretty that gay. Is a great way to let someone know you're a lesbian.
Yeah.
So basically you two are, you both work lots, you're doing comedy. Yeah. You're doing comedy. I know Carly, you're always supporting his comedy, and I think that that's really beautiful too. How is it watching him up on stage?
I love it. I think I've only missed one show so far of all of his shows, which is a little devastating, but I love comedy, you know, and I was getting really frustrated. I lived in Halifax for a long time. I moved here in 2019. And yeah, I was getting really frustrated with the music scene, with the comedy scene. And it is just, there's like a lot of support for really problematic comedy, you know, and it's just not funny, you know, and it's not... Anyway, so I actually saw B perform in May of 2019, and we met in December officially. Not that I was like stalking him or anything, but I remember being like, this guy's really funny. Like, this is really funny. It's silly. It's honest. It's real. Like, there's so much comedy in just like our weird, awkward lives that, yeah. You know, yeah.
And it's not the heavy self-deprecating comedy that a lot of people put out there, which I mean, is a style on its own, but I think it is nice to see comedy that's a little softer, but still wild, still kooky. I think that's super important. It keeps people smiling and laughing. Yeah. Did you do comedy?
No.
She's okay.
That's what I thought I was going to say. I'm very not on stage. I feel like just thinking about it, I'm sweating right now. Like, this is enough for me, thinking that there's people watching me. I'm just glad I can't see them, you know? But like, I had to go on stage once, you know, and it was not good. So
once is enough.
Enthusiastic supporter.
She's a great audience member. Yes. She's very enthusiastic. Yes. If I'm writing something new, I will run it past her. And if she doesn't laugh hard enough, then I know that I have to change it to make it more outrageous.
How did you feel when Carly, I mean, the first time you probably didn't know that they were watching you, but once you had that connection, what was it like knowing that she was in the crowd watching?
What was the first show? I don't even remember.
I was really nervous. You had some pals come out, but when she tells me the story about how she first saw me on stage, the way that you told me it was very sweet. And she said that she thought I was a cutie pie. And she said, I waited after the show to buy you a drink. And I thought that was so wild because I had no self-esteem and I was so anxious. No one has ever bought me a drink. Like, I do my time on stage and then I go home. And so in no world did I think that, mm-hmm. you know,
There's someone waiting by the
bar. A lovely lady would be waiting to buy me a drink. She's like, yeah, I wish you came. I was trying to buy you a drink. I was like, why?
That's so adorable.
For her to come watch me. But now I don't know what happened this year. I think because last year was so a lot of stuff happened. Mm-hmm.
Can talk about that too if you want to. I don't know if you're talking about what I'm thinking you're talking about, but if you want to share what we earlier discussed.
Sorry. Sure. So last year, oh my gosh, this is such a large story, but I think it largely contributes to how I have come back with comedy. Do you want Carly here still? I feel like...
No, Carly can still stay if she wants. Yeah, for sure. This is your main supporter. It just makes sense.
She likes being on camera. Yeah, she was wrangling our cats in the background. They're desperate to get on this desk. I feel like... So my parents got a divorce when I was in my 20s, and I had an estranged relationship with my dad, and I had been trying over the last a very long time to make amends and just get in contact with him. And there was a lot of addiction and sadness, and I didn't want the next thing I heard about my father to be that he had died. So I've been trying for a long time to get into contact with him, to just say, you know, whatever happened in our past, all is forgiven. I hope you're good. I didn't want him to think that there are people against him. His life is hard enough. And so over the last year, or was it 2 years ago? I have no
concept. 2022, it was... May 2022.
Oh, last year. Yeah. Sorry. I have no concept of time anymore. All in the same week, I found out that I had COVID, which isn't the worst thing in the world, except that that day or the day after, I found out that my father was in the hospital down the street from me and he was dying. Mm-hmm. And so having COVID meant that I couldn't go and do that. And everything was so large and so awful. And then our pal, Biff, who the day after I found out I had COVID and my dad was dying, Biff called me and she said, I'm doing this show, this Canadian Music Week show. Do you want to host it? And I just started crying and laughing. And I said, everything is so bad. And this is the biggest dream of my whole life. And everything is so bad. And she was so lovely and laughed with me, and she was like fuck kid.
She is lovely. She is so lovely.
She is the best. And I just kind of lost my mind a bit, and I feel like you said that I could be dark, so I'm
and understandably your mind is, you know, what you went through, and that is a really hard thing to talk about.
He held on until my COVID was done and I was good. And then I remember calling my aunts who were in the hospital, who I hadn't seen in decades. And I was like, I'm good. I don't have COVID anymore. I'm going to come and say goodbye. And I remember they said, he said he doesn't feel good and he'll call you back. And I was like, I don't think he has that time. Like, this is crazy. And so the last thing my dad ever said to me was, I'll call you back, which is funny because it is the worst thing in the entire world. And so I lost my mind. Like, on top of not having any closure, my brother and I were solely responsible for his entire apartment and all of his belongings. So we had to piece together our own closure by looking through all of his things. Mm-hmm. And his apartment was like a time capsule from when my parents were together. It was so large. And so I hadn't done comedy in years. And I was like, I'm never doing comedy again. Like, my brain and my heart are broken. So we had so much stuff to get rid of. So I started writing the craziest, silliest ads I could think of to get to find his special things homes, and people were responding. And so then I was like, I don't feel like being funny. And so I started writing the most honest, probably devastating ads I could think of. Just like, I am having a horrible day. This is how I know this thing that I would like to find a home for. And that garnered the attention of, like, we had just moved into this area, and this developed a whole community of people who were really invested in this weird journey that I was like making everyone pay attention to.
You were sharing it on social media too. Like, I remember this.
Yeah. And so that really got me back into comedy, well, writing, because things were just so awful. And then I met all these people who we were joking around that were part of the Dead Parents Club. And it's awful, but it's funny because it's so sad and no one knows what to say. And you have these things thrown at you that you don't know what to do with them. And so I kind of gave myself permission to be weird and be honest, because I don't think I have the patience anymore to be anything other than honest and weird with everyone. And you like me for some reason, so I think it's working.
I think it's really important to be honest and weird. I'm so tired of fake things, fake people. Authenticity, knowing somebody's authentic, you know, I love that.
Yeah, me too. I mean, it's so exhausting to have to be on. And that's what I was saying to Christine before we started this, is that this feels so nice and normal and just like a really lovely conversation between pals about, you know, whatever we want to talk about.
And the stuff that you're talking about, like, you don't even realize who it's going to help, because one, you know, you could be I have a range of different people that watch the stuff that I put out. And I share at churches, like United Churches, Affirming Churches. I let them know, like, you never know who's going to be watching this story. And that's part of what I love about it, because you could literally like take somebody who feels so isolated and alone and show them that it's possible to have a happy life and a partner and a good job and to have a smile on your face.
I feel like you spend a lot of your time saying really kind, lovely things to people, but I hope that you also feel your importance to.
I'll be honest, I do. I know the importance, and I feel honored that I've been able to like use this platform to like start a lot of conversations that wouldn't have happened. So no, yeah. I understand. It's important.
Oh, good. Because you are so important and you are so likable and disarming in the most lovely of ways. Like,
well, that is so nice to hear, especially disarming part.
Yeah, totally. That's a funny word to use, but I know that you get it.
I do get it. So we are coming up on the end of the show. I want to thank you so much for all of the things you shared. I want to thank Carly for coming on and sharing with us a bit too. We're going to do a Q&A, and I'm really excited about that. I hope that we've got some people that have some questions for you, but I just want to thank you so much for coming on the show and chatting with me.
Falynn, I love you and I appreciate you. Can we do our bedtime stories with me? Little nighttime goodbye, but I'm here for the questions. Okay, I just wanted to tell you that I hope you had a really nice day today, and Christine too, and both of you did your best, and everybody that's watching, and your best is more than good enough, and I'm proud of you, and I appreciate you, and I love you.
That's amazing. Christine, can we welcome you back?
Yes, thank you, I'm here. I feel like I needed
to feel so good right now.
I know, I feel like
I feel so good. Thank you, B.
These conversations are so lovely, but I feel like at the end of this, if we were in person, we would just have like a really big group hug. And I feel like what you said, B, was like, it was like a hug across the internet. So thank you.
Oh, good.
So I'm really excited. I forgot to mention when I did my little spiel at the beginning about the Q&A session, like I usually do. So apologize to everybody for not mentioning that at the start, that we do a Q&A, and how you can participate to anyone joining us on Zoom is you can click on the little Q&A button right at the bottom of your screen, and you can type in your question and I will read it out. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, you can put your comments or you can put your question into the comment section, because I'm monitoring that as well. And again, I will read your question out for you. And I will say that I think this is the first time that this has happened, but we had questions start coming in right from the very start. So I'm very excited for this Q&A. Our first question is, how does it feel to now be comfortable with yourself and inspiring others at the same time?
Oh, that's so nice. It is really sweet and lovely to have words like that used. It makes me feel a little bit, it's very humbling to have words like that. And I'm fighting saying something like, the word inspiring is really nice. And it is strange to think of anyone thinking of me that way. And I'm trying really hard not to fight my urge to downplay such a lovely thing, but it is so lovely. And it makes me feel really excited, because the people that, I mean, it doesn't even count. I was saying the other day that my first experience with knowing anything queer was my sex ed in grade 6. We were shown 3 episodes of Degrassi, and one of them was when Caitlin had a crush on her teacher. And it was so awful for a kid to be like, that's what, you know, and all the kids are making fun of her in this class. And so I feel like for a while, I was like, I do not want to be that. And then I went to high school, and high school was really hard. And so in my last year of high school, I switched to this alternative school, and everyone at that school was a weirdo and queer. And it was so nice to feel not othered and not on high alert of feeling so uncomfortable all the time. So it is so strange to me. I was saying to Carly the other day, we were out for dinner and someone called me sir, which is wild to be called a sir, but I hardly get misgendered at all anymore. And I spent so many years getting misgendered and having it really like rock me and feel terrible, that it is so strange to live in a world where I do feel comfortable. That the mistakes that I make now in my comfort are very funny. Like Carly and I went to a concert and I came back from the bathroom, because now I exclusively use the men's bathroom. And going into the girls' bathroom my whole life, it's very normal to be like, cute top, like, how's your night going? And so I went to the men's bathroom and I looked, I made eye contact with someone and I said, hi. And he looked at me like I was such a pervert. And I was like, oh my God, you can't talk to people in the bathroom. This is so weird. And so I came in the bathroom like, oh my God, you can't talk to guys in the bathroom. This is such a weird world to exist in now. And so sometimes I feel like I'm too comfortable, because I'm just myself. And I don't know, that's one silly example. I'm very long-winded, but it's really lovely to feel like anyone is inspired by me being honest about things. I've especially covet this wonderful community of kids, of queer kids who have been tuning into my stuff and messaging me. And it's like, wow, you're, you know, a preteen and you already have a grasp on who you are. Anybody that lets me in on their life and has told me that I've helped them in any way, I feel that's so valuable, and I feel so honored.
Love that.
Beautiful. All right, we've got a few more questions. When you do your comedy, do you feel inspired making people happy and laugh? I feel people need more of you in this world.
That's so nice. Yeah, I feel like, I always joke with Carly, I say to her, kind of kidding, I don't care if you think I'm the best looking guy in the world or the most charming, but I need you to think I'm the most funny. That's what I feel like is so important all the time.
I would say making people laugh is his favorite thing in the whole world. And if people don't laugh at him, that is the worst thing in the whole world.
Yeah. I'll just keep repeating myself and be like, I don't think you heard me, because what I just said. But it is thrilling, especially if I'm feeling anxious and having a bad night and I'm still like going to do the show. It is thrilling to me to see people laugh at what I think is funny or to laugh at something silly I did or said. And it just like, I don't know, it just changes my whole brain and it just like gets me more focused.
That's awesome.
So this next question came in while you were answering your first question. And the first part of it is a statement, and I will say it is all in caps. And they say, you inspired me tonight.
Inspire, the word of the day.
No, but that's the word of the day.
I love it.
How does this make you feel? Because you made me feel not alone for being me. That was hard to get out.
Oh, that really got me too.
Got me.
I think that's, I mean, what's better than that? That's the best. Thank you for taking the time to let me know that. And whoever wrote that, you did your best, and your best is more than good enough. And I'm really proud of you. And you're not alone. What a beautiful thing for you to take the time. Thank you. That was really nice. Thank you.
All right. And we have one more question for now, but if anybody wants to add another quick one, please feel free to do so. So this last question is, of all your books, what was your favorite bedtime story as a kid? And now, what's your favorite as a reader sharing with others?
Oh, man. My favorite book still, and I'm going to get it tattooed on me one day, is Leo the Late Bloomer. The art is just like classic 80s, and it's just about this sweet little tiger who just, he's a late bloomer and he's taking his time. And I think I loved it so much because his family is just like, it's okay. Let him do his thing. He'll be there one day. Maybe he's not the mightiest lion, or maybe he's a little, you know, slower, or he's not doing all the lion things, you know, or sorry, tiger things right away. But and then at the end, he's just like, here I am. And he, spoiler alert, he blooms. And he's just so happy. And everyone's like, yeah, there you are. And it's so valuable. And that's definitely my favorite kids book. And my favorite book right now, that's really hard. I hope that people will tune in. You could look at old ones at hashtag bedtime stories with B, but this is such a cool time in the world because Carly and I have bought so many books on like queerness and like queer kids and trans kids, and there's all different ethnicities of different types of families, and not, you know, growing up all the books were like white kids, you know, and so there's so many types of books out there and so many cool bookstores that we've just bought a whole bunch, and I'm really excited to read all of those and see what resonates with people.
Awesome.
So I think that's it for our questions for tonight.
Great question, by the way. Thank you.
Those were fantastic questions.
Yeah, those were awesome.
And I think that just the comments in general that were made in the questions as well prove why this series is so important and why the museum is so honored to have Falynn and all of your special guests come and have these conversations in the community. The importance of them cannot be stressed enough. And I thank you both so much for coming out tonight. Falynn, did you want to say anything else?
I just wanted to say thank you for anybody that tuned in, anyone that asked questions. I hope that when this is done, that you'll keep the conversation going. Maybe tomorrow you can tell somebody something lovely or kind. And let's just make this world a kinder place and a more accepting place for everyone. Good night. Yeah.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you, Falynn. Love you guys.
Thank you, B. Take care. Bye, Carly.
Bye, everyone.